float on in onto the crashing wave. Step out of my comfort zone to the realm of the unknown where Jesus is. And he's holding out his hand. Wait for calling out my name and the light of me. Reminding me of all the time I've tried before and failed. Wait to keep on telling me. To listen and believe the voice of truth. Oh, what I would do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant. Or just a swing and a stone, surrounded by the sound of a thousand. Shaking in their armor, wishing they had the strength to stand. Giants calling out my name, and he laughs at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The giant keeps on telling me. Story. The voice of truth says, do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says, it is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I will choose to listen and believe the voice.
Good morning. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, our strength, we confess that we are captive to the power of sin that dwells within us. We put ourselves first and others last. What we think will make us happy leaves us longing for more. Even when we want to do what is good, we find ourselves doing the opposite. Rescue us from the death's grip on our lives and raise us up day by day that we may be alive to God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Rise and sing.
To seek his face at, we lift our voices to heaven above. He inhabits the people's praises. He comes with are gathered.
Living together in trust and hope, we proclaim our faith. We believe in one God in three persons, a triple bloom on a single stem. God the Father, who created the universe and is continually creating us. God the Son, who redeemed us by coming and pitching his tent next to ours. God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us and is the love that gives our life meaning. We worship one God in three, and three in one, and this belief is life everlasting.
Here we are.
let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Lord, we confess we have brought division in our world and in our lives. We have built walls that divide and let hostility grow among us. We have tried to save ourselves by our own actions. We take your grace for granted. We have failed to be the people you have called us to be. We are sorry. Forgive us.
Today we are going to look at two saints who probably are also known for being two sinners, Paul and Peter. And if they're sinners that need the grace of God, we see how much we need the grace of God. So that grace comes to us in these words, that for the sake of Jesus Christ, God Almighty forgives you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord. Grace, mercy, peace, and love of God be with you all. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. I invite you to be seated. You may not know this, but Rose Holbein has been busy collating and organizing all of our baptismal records because something they did in her former church was every quarter, they would gather all the children who were baptized during that quarter in some year and have them come forward and have a special baptismal remembrance service or an anniversary of baptism. So I would like those who received the letter, or if you know when your child was baptized and we happen to miss you and they were baptized in the months of, is it March, April, June? This quarter, come forward. Oh boy, everyone has a baptismal candle. Here's what we're going to do first. We're going to light that candle. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life." And when you two were baptized, I know when Daniel was baptized at least, an assisting minister handed your parents a baptismal candle that they're holding, and that assisting minister said these words, "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Now listen to this reading from Galatians. "In Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus." So, what I want you parents to do is look at your young one and say these words. The words are right on the screen, and put the mark, the sign of the cross on their foreheads as you say those words. Very good. You know what? I'm going to ask you two to stand up. I can have my hand on your heads. And we're going to say a prayer. Almighty God, who gives us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and forgives us all our sins, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right. If you remember, I think I missed something. Maybe I didn't. But the congregation said something that day, that they promised to do everything they could, and they promised to do everything they could to help you to grow in faith. And I'm going to ask the congregation if they still promise to do that. And if you do, say, yes, by the help of God. And now, receive one last blessing. Almighty God, who gives us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and forgives us all our sins, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Haley, congratulations on the anniversary of your baptism. Daniel, congratulations on the anniversary of your baptism. You may take your seats now. To say things did not work well in the early service is an understatement. Everything from microphones not working to Marilyn missing an action at the organ, but we got through it. Hopefully we'll go through this one today too. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We are going to look at Apostles Peter and Paul. This is their commemorative day. The title of the sermon is The God of Second Chances. Now, you might go, who cares? Peter and Paul, commemorative day, that's a bunch of ancient stuff, ancient people found important, so what? Well, we're going to find out. It's always good to look at the lives of these people because they often give us encouragement in life too. This is the martyrdom of Peter. Notice that, by the way, both Peter and Paul supposedly were killed on June 29th. Now, not the same year, but in the mid to late 70s, excuse me, mid to late 60s, 67, 68 AD. Here's the martyrdom of Peter. Peter was going to be hanged. And rather than, he was going to be crucified on a cross. But he said, I am unworthy to be crucified on a cross the way Christ was crucified on the cross. So hang me upside down. And this shows you that they're putting him upside down on the cross and raising him up. Paul, on the other hand, was a little bit older than Peter when he was martyred. You notice there's his torso, and you notice right there is his head. This is one of the least grotesque pictures of the martyrdom of St. Paul I could find. But he was beheaded. Now, let's look at Peter for a second. We have this text today, and it's a text.
Yeah,
of course, Jesus rose from the dead. Peter is getting bored. He tells the disciples, I'm going fishing. Seven of them follow, and they go out fishing one day, fish all night, didn't catch a thing. They see someone walking along shore who yells out to them, throw your net on the other side, and they're going, oh, boy, we've been doing this all night. But they go and do it anyway. Catch this huge catch of fish. When they get it to shore, there's 153 fish. And Peter realizes it's Jesus, and he goes jumping into the water and runs to shore. And there, Jesus had a charcoal fire going, and he's roasting fish, ready to feed them breakfast. But one of the things that we notice, and those people who spend their lives just studying scripture recognize the word used for charcoal fire is the same word only used in the Gospel of John for the charcoal fire that was used prior to Jesus' crucifixion. Remember the night Jesus was betrayed? Jesus was in the courtyard where Jesus was. Jesus arrested. Peter was warming himself at the fire. Somebody says, oh, you're a Galilean. You're one of his followers, aren't you? And Jesus said, Peter said, no, I am not. He goes to another charcoal fire, warming himself. And somebody else says, you're one of them. You're a follower of Jesus. I know you. He says, no, I am not. Finally, he goes outside the gate to another charcoal fire. And a slave says, I recognize you. You're a disciple of his. And then Peter curses and says, I do not know the man. So it becomes a very obvious situation where Peter denied Jesus three times. And then we have this text, touching text. Peter comes up to this charcoal fire. They say that the sense that we have that most makes us remember things happens to be the sense of smell. So he comes up to a charcoal fire. We can only imagine that he smelled that charcoal and was reminded of his failure. Then he's further reminded when Jesus asks him, Peter, do you love me? And Peter responds, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus says, feed my sheep. Then Jesus says again, Peter, do you love me? And Peter goes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus says, tend my sheep. And he asked him a third time, and the text says, and Peter felt bad that he asked him the third time, because obviously now John is trying to tell us. It reminded him of his other charcoal fire experience and his absolute failure. And Jesus said, tend my sheep. At the end of the text, it says, follow me. Well, we see Peter was a failure, an absolute failure. We see from that Paul was no different. These guys were real rascals when you think about it. Paul thought he was super righteous, actually super self-righteous, had papers to go and find every Jew in the Roman Empire who did not, who would confess Christ as Lord. Every Jew. So he's out trying to arrest them. He even had permission to kill them. And that's when we know God Almighty had other things in mind. He's knocked off his horse, blinded by a bright light. Here's the voice of Jesus. Christians had to be convinced, go to Paul. Even though they heard a voice telling them to go to Paul. His name was Saul at the time, of course. And God has great things for him in mind. What do we do? Here you have two people. Failures. Peter especially, denied Christ. Throughout Christian history, there have been those people, in order to save their lives, have denied Christ. There's and it's not only Christians. How about Jews during the Crusades? Eli Wiesel wrote a book. Oh, by the way, this is a picture of the Apostle Paul and Peter. Great saints, but they couldn't work together. Here they're arguing. Of course, the big thing they were arguing about is Peter was two-faced and went to eat lunch with the Jews, got up from a table of Gentiles and went to eat with Jewish believers, as though Jewish people were better than Gentiles. Eli Wiesel wrote the book Rashi. It's about a rabbi. It's about the life of and work of Solomon ben Isaac, or Rabbi Salomo Yitzhaki. They shortened his name to Rabbi Rashi. Rashi was a rabbi in Tours, France, during the First Crusade. If you remember, Pope Urban II, back in 1040. Okay, excuse me, 1095, declared the First Crusades, and Tours, France, did not fare well. The Jews there were killed if they did not confess Christ, if they did not become baptized. And the problem is, many of them, in order to save their lives, became baptized Christians. But after the Crusades, they wanted to come back. We want to be, please, let us come back. We want to come back to our roots. And Rabbi Rashi was there to help the people welcome back these people who had deserted. Now, do we do a good job of welcoming people back that are deserters? We call them traitors, don't we? Just think of what's happened nationally, politically. Sergeant Bergdahl. It was fine and dandy when he was released into American custody until someone says he's a traitor. He went AWOL. Then all of a sudden you've got all the news. Oh, who wants to help someone who went AWOL? Is he worthy? My whole thing is, he's an American. Don't know if he's a criminal or not. Let's bring him back and let him face charges if you want. And if he is a criminal, I'd like to see him in American jails rather than with the Taliban. But that's just my opinion. Isn't it hard to accept a traitor? Here's one that I'm not always so generous with, right? Snowden? Although he's a hero to some people, a traitor to others. So what about the people who are failures in the church? Well, Jesus shows us what he did with a failure, with Peter. And Paul. By the way, I dare you to go through the Bible and find one leader that wasn't terribly flawed. I'll just share two with you. Think of Moses. He murdered an Egyptian. Ran away. Becomes an adult And evidently, the statute of limitations, there must be a statute of limitations on murder in ancient Egypt, because he came back to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt. But a murderer, David, an adulterer, and a murderer. Just try to find a leader in the Bible who wasn't flawed. But we have a God of the second chance, third chance, fourth chance, 50th chance, 70 times 70th chance. You know, in the church, some of our leaders, don't we always like to poke fun of the TV evangelists? I haven't heard a TV evangelist lately having succumbed to some problem, but Jimmy Swaggart was one, Jim Baker, Ted Haggard. There have been some others, but we're all flawed in some way. It's like a pastor who writes about a lifetime friend of his. He said, something happened, and the next thing you know, he's driving 90 miles an hour down the freeway the wrong way. Gets arrested. His life is in shambles. He's fallen from his perch of being a great attorney, and now he's in trouble. And he said, the good news is, he's beginning to patch his life back together with the help of Alcoholics Anonymous, and he said, in an unlikely place for my friend, he said, in his church. Because he said his friend went to church, and it didn't mean anything to him. But all of a sudden, his friend had changed. His friend said, for some reason, I go to church now, and all the things that I couldn't understand seem to make sense to me. He says, even the word, even though he goes go to a church that doesn't believe in being born again, but even the term born again means something to me. And he said those words of Jesus where he says you must die in order to find life. And you must take up your cross daily and follow me. He said, for some reason, my hitting bottom helped me in my Christian faith. Well, we have a God of a second chance, and third chance, and fourth chance, and you name it. Kelly Fryer used to be an ELCA Lutheran pastor. Very talented pastor, very gifted. She is an author of books. In fact, one of her books, No Experience Necessary, many of you have read. And in that book, she said, my church is a holy mess. I think she meant the ELCA as a denomination. My church is a holy mess. Now let's back up and talk about Kelly Fryer for a second. She divorced her husband. It was a terrible thing to do. And the circumstances were terrible. A lot of hurt. Announced that she was a lesbian. Got married. Partnered with her lesbian partner. And that's when the ELCA at the time took her off the clergy roster. She says, she writes, my church is a holy mess. And then she says, if its messiness is due to me, that's one thing. I probably and why my church is a holy mess. But the Holy, let me rephrase that. I am the reason my church is a mess. God in Christ is the reason my church is holy. God in Christ is the reason my church is holy. I don't know about you. I like what Kelly Fryer says, because every week I come, and the thing I like about church is God in Christ welcomes me. And I don't know about you, but during the week, my life is a series of failures. Oh, there's some successes there too, but it's a series of failures. And I'm glad that every week I come, God forgives me. And then, every week when I come, Jesus says to me, come on, follow me. Every week, God calls you, God welcomes you. Doesn't matter how many failures you've had, because he forgives you. And then every week he calls you again and says, follow me. Amen.
Rise and sing as we share our tithes and offerings.
You are more than the choices that you make. You are more than the sum of your past.
a place of welcome. As you forgive, as you welcome, as you call, Lord, in your mercy, God of creation, you are the marvel of all living things that inhabit our planet. Help us to preserve and protect the common life we share with all creation. Lord, in your mercy. God of peace, we pray for the nations of the world. Help leaders and people that despite differences of color, creed, and custom, help us to live in peace. We remember especially the Ukraine, Syria, and Iraq. Lord, in your mercy. God of healing, we pray for those who struggle with doubt, despair, and the search for meaning. We pray that you send your healing, especially to Maria von Brandt, Eric Carlson, Shonda Cartwright, Amanda Davis, Rosemary Decker, Terry Pentris, Robert Gipner, Richard Green, Mike Eisenberg, Jim Moran, Angie Myers, Wayne Myers, Suzanne Noh, Bud Norton, Jim Quisenberry, Gene Richards, Amanda Rourke, Sharon Stevenson, Sharon Severson, Gary Shoemaker, Mary Thomas, and Ann Wilbur. Are there any others? Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the saints who have kept the faith and now rest in you. We pray that you help those who are grieving, especially family and friends of Louise Alford, Stephen Fisher, George Lindsay, Bonnie McEwen, and Jim McCoy. Lord, in your mercy. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food. Body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. You may be seated. It's the fifth Sunday of the month, therefore we commune via intinction, which means You will receive the bread or a wafer in your hand, hold on to it until the wine comes by, and dip or tinct it into the wine. Second oldest known form of communion in history. Again, all is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come.
Bring me to my knees.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, through the gifts of his body and blood, strengthen, keep, and unite us, now and forever. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that through this meal you feed us, you call us, you send us out to spread your good news. Help us to do that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I have my own. I don't need that.
Sounds good.
I come prepared. Good morning. I have just a few announcements. We have the prayer cube. Some of you ordered those from me. But if you haven't ordered them, I have a bunch of extras. They're a set of three. There's one for mealtimes, bedtimes, and there's one for friendships, so come check those out at the welcome desk. We have our silent auction still going on for the weekend at the Blue Green Wilderness Lodge at Big Cedar. I never get the name right. It's a lot of words. It's a really great weekend. That is still up for bid. We will take the last bid in about a half an hour at 12:30. So check that out. That's on the welcome desk. And also, the youth have just finished an entire week of service projects. They were doing that to help raise money for their trip to Detroit next summer. So they're actually all right back there. They're not all back there, but Jay's over there and the Melgrins are back there. I'd like to give them just a round of applause. They worked really hard this week. They've done a lot of good. So, yeah.
There's a brochure in the back, and I really put this together for the parents of those who are who have the anniversary of the baptism, but any of you might want to pick this up, and it gives you 10 ways to nurture baptismal faith at home. It begins by making a general comment that in baptism, God says, you are mine, I love you, you are washed and made new. And God's family, us, we say, we welcome you, let us serve together. And a couple of points. The first place your child experiences the tangible love of God is in your own arms. So remember to say, I love you. I'm grateful that God has given us a gift of love to share with each other. And it gives 10 pointers like that. Anyway, there are copies in the back in case you want one. Receive this benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace that sustains every breath we take, the love of God that gives us courage and strength, and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit that fills our hearts with comfort and peace, be with you and all those you care about, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
we welcome all to worship. Make disciples, hunger for ministry, nurture youth, gather resources for growing ministries, and offer healing and care to all in need. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.